For several purposes of the law of partnership, it becomes necessary to determine the joint property of the partners, that is, the property of the firm as opposed to the personal property of the partners. For example, on the dissolution of a firm, the firm debts are first paid out of the joint assets. Again, partnership property can be used only for the purposes of the business of the firm. Further, during the subsistence of the partnership, no partner can deal with any portion of the property as his own, nor he can assign his interest in a specific item of the partnership property to anyone. Now, what constitutes a partnership property? It is for the partners to determine by their agreement what shall be the property of the firm. Section 14 lays down rules for ascertaining the intention of the partners for this purpose. Number one is property originally brought in. The first rule is that unless a different intention appears, the property of the firm includes all property and rights and interests in property originally brought into the stock of the firm. In other words, whatever property is thrown into the common stock at the commencement of the business becomes the property of the firm. Thus, where a grocer, provisional dealer, and wine merchant took two partners into the business who contributed no capital, and the merchant continued to purchase stock in trade for the firm with his own money, it was held on the bankruptcy of the firm that the stock in trade had become the property of the firm. In Miles versus Clark, the plaintiff and the defendant constituted a partnership of professional photographers. The leasehold premises, furniture, and the studio equipment belonged to the defendant, but both partners contributed to the stock in trade. On the dissolution of the firm, it was held that only the stock in trade was joint property, the rest remaining the personal property of the defendant. Goodwill and trademarks. Section 14 in the concluding words of its first paragraph says that the expression property of the firm includes also the goodwill of the business. In Commissioner of Gift Tax versus Chotala Mohanlal, though trademarks, patents, copyrights, etc. are not specifically mentioned, they being important rights constituting what is described as an intellectual property, have to be regarded as property of the firm. Number second is property subsequently acquired. The next rule is that the property acquired by purchase or otherwise, by or for the firm, or for the purposes and in the course of the business of the firm belongs to the firm. This was held in Ray versus Ware, where a property is purchased with the money of the firm but in the name of a partner. The presumption is that it belongs to the firm. Thus, where one partner brought shares in his own name but with the money of the firm, the shares were held to be partnership property. Number third is partner's property in the firm's use. Where the personal property of the partner is being used in the business of the firm, it is a question of fact to be determined by reference to the party's intention whether it has become the property of the firm. The well-known illustration is the case of Robinson versus Austin. The owner of a cotton mill entered into partnership with the two others. The business was carried on at his mill. The value of the assets of the mill was credited to his capital account and he was allowed interest on it. The mill was enlarged and improved by the firm, and also new buildings were erected on land acquired by the firm. It was held that the mill had become the property of the firm. Mere use of a partner's property by the firm does not make it a property of the firm. In this case, one partner contributed his land and the other constructed the cinema hall, built on it, keeping with the agreement to run it in partnership. The court said that the land had remained the property of the lady owner and the person who provided the structure on it had the right to remove it. Last one is conversion of joint into separate property. Where certain property is purchased with partnership money but in the name and for the sole benefit of a partner, he becomes debtor to the firm for the purchase of money. It becomes the personal property of the partner. Similarly, where on the dissolution of a firm, a part of the joint properties is allotted to a partner, it becomes his separate property.